Hello friends, welcome to the Viva Voss of Anatomy. Today we see the external feature of the cerebral hemisphere and the different sulci and the gyri on it. Each cerebral hemisphere is having the three pole, three border and three surface. The three pole are, the first one, the anterior one is known as the frontal pole, which is rounded. The posterior pole is known as the occipital pole, which is pointed, and between the frontal and the occipital pole in the lower part there is a temporal pole. Now the three border, before that we see the surface, three surface. The first most extensive and the convex is a superolateral surface. This one is a superolateral surface. The second is a flat, that is a medial surface. The flat medial surface. The flat medial surface of the two cerebral hemispheres are approximated with each other. And the last one is an inferior surface. This is an inferior surface. Now the inferior surface is divided into the orbital surface and the tentorial surface by a stem of a lateral surface. Now we see the border. The first superomedial border. This is the superomedial border which separates the superolateral surface from the medial surface. The second inferolateral border. This is the inferolateral border. The inferolateral border separates the superolateral surface from the inferior surface. Now the anterior part of the inferolateral border is known as a superciliary border. The third border is a medial border. The medial border, this one is a medial border which separates the inferior surface from the medial surface. Now it is having two parts. The anterior part which separates the orbital part from the medial surface is known as a medial orbital border, and the posterior part which separates the tentorial part from the medial surface, which is known as a medial occipital border. So these are the external parts or a feature of the cerebral hemisphere. Now we see the main three sulci of the cerebral hemisphere, which divides each cerebral hemisphere into the four main lobes. These are, the first is a lateral sulcus. The lateral sulcus starts at the inferior surface. It lies between the orbital and the tentorial part of the inferior surface. This is the stem of the lateral sulcus. Now the lateral sulcus reaches laterally on the superolateral surface over here, and now here it is divided into three ramus. This is the anterior horizontal, anterior ascending and the posterior ramus. So this is the lateral sulcus and its three ramus. The second main sulcus lies on the superolateral surface, which is a central sulcus. The central sulcus lies approximately 1 cm behind the midpoint of a frontal and the occipital pole. The central sulcus. Central sulcus will go downward and the forward, and it will end just above the posterior ramus of a lateral sulcus. The third sulcus, which lies on the medial surface, is a parieto-occipital sulcus. This is the medial surface. This is the posterior part. The parieto-occipital sulcus. This is the parieto-occipital sulcus that lies somewhat 5 to 6 cm in front of the frontal pole. Parieto-occipital sulcus. And the parieto-occipital sulcus will cut the superomedial border and extend on the superolateral surface. Now these three sulcus divide the each cerebral hemisphere into four lobes. These lobes are frontal lobe, parietal lobe, occipital lobe and temporal lobe. The frontal lobe, it lies in front of the central sulcus and above the posterior ramus of a lateral sulcus. So this is a frontal lobe. Now to divide the rest of the three lobes, we use the parieto-occipital sulcus that cuts the superomedial border, and the pre-occipital nose, which lies in front of occipital pole. So we will make a vertical line which is joining the preoccipital notch and the parieto-occipital sulcus. This is a vertical line. And the second horizontal line in the line with the posterior ramus of a central sulcus. So these two lines divide the rest of the cerebral hemisphere into three lobes. The part in front of the vertical line and the horizontal line, below the horizontal line, is a temporal lobe. The part behind the vertical line is a occipital lobe, and the part above the horizontal line and in front of the vertical line is a parietal lobe. Now, apart from these four lobes, the fifth lobe is also present, but it is hidden from the view, which is a submerged portion of a brain which is known as an insula. The insula you can see in the floor of a lateral sulcus of a brain. We can see the exposed part in the second specimen here. I had removed the overlying lobes, the frontal and the temporal lobe, to see the fifth lobe that is known as the insula. This is the submerged portion of a cerebral hemisphere. The fifth, you can say it is a fifth lobe of a cerebral hemisphere. Now, it has been submerged from surface during the development of the brain due to the overgrowth of the surrounding cortical area. And it can be seen only when you can widely apart the lips of a lateral sulcus. Here you can see the fifth lobe. And over the surface of the insula, you can see there is a poorly demarcated sulci and the gyri are present. Now we see the sulci and the gyri of the cerebral hemisphere. The first we see the sulci and the gyri on the superolateral surface. In the superolateral surface, first we see the sulci and the gyri on the frontal lobe. Now in the frontal lobe, this is our central sulcus. Just in front of the central sulcus, 1 centimeter in front of it, the parallel to the central sulcus lies the precentral sulcus. This is the precentral sulcus. Now the gyrus between these two sulcus is known as the precentral gyrus. Now the gyri and the sulci are the rest of the part of a frontal lobe. The rest of the part of the frontal lobe is having a two horizontal anteroposterior sulcus, that is a superior frontal sulcus and inferior frontal sulcus, which divides the frontal lobe into the superior, the middle and the inferior frontal gyrus. Now, this inferior frontal gyrus, important, is divided by the anterior horizontal, anterior ascending and the posterior ramus of a lateral sulcus into three parts. The part below the anterior horizontal is known as the pars orbitalis. The parts between the anterior horizontal and the anterior ascending is known as the pars triangularis, and the part between the anterior ascending and the posterior ramus is known as the pars operculus. So these are the sulci and the gyri of the frontal lobe. Now we see on the temporal lobe. The temporal lobe, you can see the two sulci, the superior and the inferior temporal sulci, which divides the temporal lobe into three gyri, the superior temporal gyri, middle and the inferior temporal gyri. Now the sulci and the gyri on the parietal lobe. Just behind the central sulcus, you will have the one more parallel to it, the sulci which is known as a post-central sulcus. And the gyrus between these two sulcus is known as a post-central gyrus. Now, behind the post-central sulcus, the parietal lobe is divided by the one horizontal sulcus, which is known as the intraparietal sulcus, into the superior parietal lobe and the inferior parietal lobe. Now, the last part in the occipital lobe.
Occipital lobe is divided by lateral occipital sulcus into superior and the inferior occipital gyrus. Now, the superior and the inferior occipital gyrus is separated from the occipital pole by the one more sulcus, which is known as a lunate sulcus.
So these are the sulci and the gyri of a superior lateral surface. Now we see on the median surface. Now on the median surface, the one main sulcus that lies start behind and below the posterior end of a corpus callosum is the callosum. Calcarine sulcus. The calcarine sulcus is going backwards toward the occipital pole with the convexity facing upward. This is the calcarine sulcus. Now from somewhere from the middle of the calcarine sulcus arises the parieto-occipital sulcus which goes superiorly and posteriorly and cuts the superior medial border. Now one important sulcus, the main demarcated sulcus that lies start just in front of and below the anterior end of the corpus callosum, that is a cingulate sulcus. Now it will arch above the corpus callosum and then in the posterior part it will ascend upward to cut the superomedial wall. This is cingulate sulcus. Now the gyrus between the corpus callosum and the cingulate sulcus is known as a cingulate gyrus. Now the sulcus which present between the corpus callosum and the cingulate gyrus is known as a callosal sulcus. Now here we can see one offshoot sulcus. The offshoot sulcus which arises from the cingulate sulcus extend above, which divides the medial surface into two parts. The smaller posterior part that lies around this sulcus, which is known as a paracentral lobule, which is corresponding to the area around the central sulcus. And the anterior area is known as a medial frontal gyrus. Now here we have seen, this is the calcarine sulcus. This is the parieto-occipital sulcus. Now this is the posterior part of the calcarine sulcus, or you can say the post-calcarine sulcus. Now the part between the post-calcarine sulcus and the parieto-occipital sulcus is known as a cuneus. This triangular part is known as a cuneus. Now the part in front of the cuneus, between the cuneus and the paracentral lobule, is known as a precuneus. Now you can see the small sulcus above the splenium of a corpus callosum is known as a suprasplenial sulcus. Now the part between the anterior part of a calcarine sulcus and the splenium is known as a isthmus. This part is known as a isthmus. So these are the front sulci and the gyri of a medial surface. Now we see the sulci and the gyri on the inferior surface of the cerebral hemisphere. First, in the orbital part. In the orbital part, towards the midline, below the olfactory bulb and the tract, you will have the straight sulcus. This is known as the olfactory sulcus. Now, the gyrus immediate medial to it is known as the gyrus rectus. Now, the rest of the part of the orbital surface will shows the irregular H-shaped sulcus, which is known as the orbital sulcus. And this H-shaped sulcus divides the rest of the part into the four gyrus: the anterior orbital gyrus, posterior orbital gyrus, lateral orbital gyrus, and the medial orbital gyrus. Now, on the tentorial surface, there are two sulcus: one medial that extend anterior posteriorly, one is medial, which is known as a collateral sulcus, and one is a lateral, which is known as a temporo-occipital sulcus. Now, just medial to the posterior part of a collateral sulcus, this part is separated from the calcarine sulcus. This is the calcarine sulcus that we have seen. So this part is known as a lingual gyrus. And the lingual gyrus, anteriorly, it is continuous with the parahippocampal gyrus. Now you can see the anterior most part of the parahippocampal gyrus is turned softly backwards. It will hooked backwards sharply. This sharp turned part is known as a uncus. This is known as a uncus, and the sulcus lateral to the uncus is known as a rhinal sulcus. This is rhinal sulcus. Now, the gyrus, which lies between the collateral sulcus and the temporo-occipital sulcus, is known as a medial temporo-occipital gyrus. And the gyrus which is lateral to the temporo-occipital sulcus is known as a lateral temporo-occipital gyrus. So these are the sulci and the gyri on the inferior surface. Now we see the type, the classification of a sulci. The first classification of the sulci is according to its development. According to its development, the sulci are of two types. The one is a primary and the second is a secondary. The primary are developed independently. So most of the sulci of a cerebral hemisphere are the primary, except the central, the lateral sulcus and the parieto-occipital sulcus, which are secondary in the development because their development depends on the other factor. Now the second classification is according to the function. According to the function, it is of a three type, either limiting, axial or operculated. The example of the limiting sulcus is the central sulcus, because the central sulcus, it divides the primary motor area in front from the primary sensory area behind. The second is a axial sulcus. The post-axial, post-calcarine sulcus is an example of an axial sulcus, because the around the post-axial sulcus lies the visual area. So the visual area lies in the long axis, along the long axis of the post-calcarine sulcus. That's why it is known as an axial sulcus. The third is an operculated sulcus. The example of the operculated sulcus is a lunate sulcus, because the lips of a lunate sulcus will present the different area, and in its wall and the floor is having the third functional different area. So this is a operculated lunate sulcus. Now the third classification is a complete or incomplete sulcus. The complete sulcus is the sulcus which make an impression in the cavity of the lateral ventricle of the brain. The such sulcus are the calcarine sulcus. This is the calcarine sulcus. The calcarine sulcus, the anterior part make an impression on the posterior horn of the lateral sulcus in its medial horn and produce the calcar iris. So the first example of a complete sulcus is a calcarine sulcus. The second is a collateral sulcus, which we have seen on the inferior surface. The collateral sulcus will produce the prominence, which is known as a collateral aminus, in the floor of an inferior horn of a lateral ventricle. The rest of the sulcus are known as an incomplete sulcus, as they will not make an impression within the cavity of a lateral ventricle. Now, the sulci and the gyri are different in the shape and the size in the different individual, because the developmentally each individual is different. But some sulci are in constant in the position that we have described. So this is all about the cerebral hemisphere and the sulci and the gyri. Thank you.
If you like this video, like it and share with your friends. And to get the regular update on the anatomy videos, please subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon.